Just before we get started with today's video, I want to thank Brilliant for sponsoring it. To support Today I Found Out and learn more about Brilliant, go to brilliant.org/todayifoundout and sign up for free. Back in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, as food began to be more and more mass-produced and shipped long distances instead of locally grown and sold fresh, it was basically the Wild West in regards to food production, and there were no real official regulations on what you could add to food, or even if you labeled something chicken, that it had to contain any chicken at all. And as there were no rules about reporting any ingredients, businesses pretty much did whatever they damn well pleased. To give you an idea of the kind of stuff that food and drug companies were cramming into things, secretly adding morphine to children's cough syrup was totally a thing, and more pertinent to the subject at hand today, commonly used preservatives back then included borax, formaldehyde, sulfuric acid, and copper sulfate, to name just a few. It also wasn't uncommon to use lead for coloring candy, or to do things like grind up various organs and scraps from animals and sell it as chicken meat. There were also people grinding up white rocks to fill out flour, and also they used sawdust, charcoal, and ground up charred animal bones to fill out coffee grounds. As an example of how widespread selling a product is one thing when it was actually something else was, in one experiment conducted by the hero of the hour, Dr. Harvey Wiley, his team found that 9 out of the 10 maple syrup brands sold in Indiana did not actually include any maple syrup in their supposedly pure maple syrup product. By the turn of the century, the state of the food industry, it had become a major cause for concern in terms of public health, but nobody was really bothering to do anything about it. And this is where Dr. Wiley enters the picture with his hygienic table trials. The experiments, they were designed to test the safety of various preservatives that were commonly used by the food industry at the time. Although they began in 1902, Dr. Wiley had been petitioning the government to conduct such experiments for a couple of decades, reportedly from almost the moment that he scored the gig of chief chemist at the Department of Agriculture in 1883. However, he was rebuffed by his bosses when food industry lobbyists caught wind of what he was up to. Finally, in 1902, though, Wiley was given about $5,000, which is about $143,000 today, and permission to do whatever was necessary to test the safety of various food preservatives. Permission in hand, he set out about finding 12 volunteers for a series of experiments that the media would come to dub the Poison Squad Trials. While you might think finding volunteers to potentially ingest something harmful to the human body would be difficult, Dr. Wiley would later note that he was inundated with requests from men, women weren't allowed to take part in the experiment, who wanted to join. For example, in one letter, the individual in question wrote, "Dear sir, I read in the paper of your experiments on diet. I have a stomach can stand anything. I have a stomach that will surprise you. I'm afflicted with 7 diseases, never went to a doctor for 15 years. They told me 15 years ago that I could not live 8 months. What do you think of it? My stomach can hold anything." Of course, it also helped that Wiley was also offering a bit of pay for the gig and providing free lodging and prepared meals for a minimum of 6 months, with the person otherwise able to go about their normal life. Owing to the nature of the experiment, volunteers were expected to be in perfect health, and during their time taking part, they were given the best medical care that money could provide. In return, all the volunteers had to do was eat whatever Wiley put in front of them and agree not to sue him or the government if they suffered serious complications. The general method used to ensure safety and figure out if the doses in common products were bad was to start with ultra-low doses and slowly ramp up over time until the subjects started having adverse effects, if they had any. As for the experiments themselves, they began by establishing a baseline for vitals on each subject over the course of a few weeks, and then the fun began. They started with borax, which was commonly used to preserve meat at the time. Initially, the plan was to add the borax to the food, but Wiley quickly noted that as the dosage ramped up, the volunteers started avoiding anything the borax was added to due to its strong metallic taste. Thus, he simply began giving volunteers a capsule full of borax at the end of each meal instead. To keep track of any and all effects the borax had on the volunteers, their vital signs were carefully measured several times a day, and they were forbidden from eating any outside food so as to not contaminate the findings. Each man's poop and pee was analyzed extensively, and every volunteer was given a medical satchel containing various vials and containers they were asked to do their business into during their day-to-day lives away from the house that the experiment was taking place in. The effects of the borax were noticed within weeks, with volunteers complaining of everything from headaches to depression, and symptoms got more and more severe as time went on. That That said, for the most part, volunteers, who were occasionally rotated out when transitioning to a new substance to minimize the chances of long-term health problems, remained in good spirits for the 5 years that the experiments took place. Notable exceptions to this were a few months into the borax experiments, when volunteers briefly went on strike due to symptoms becoming severe, as well as when they did trials that involved formaldehyde. At the time, formaldehyde was commonly used as a preservative in various dairy products, but caused such debilitating illness in volunteers almost right away that Wiley cut the experiment short out of concern for their safety. Other than this, the group that the media would come to dub the Poison Squad seemed to enjoy the experiments, and some of the things they tested didn't have any apparent adverse effects. One of the substances which didn't cause any effects was sodium benzoate, which made for a rather pleasant few months for that set of volunteers. To add a touch of class to the proceedings, volunteers would dress in formal attire for evening meals, which, in addition to making these meals seem fancy, made for excellent publicity shots. Shots which appeared in papers across the country alongside stories discussing the details of the experiments. These stories were immensely popular with the public, particularly when the substances were causing ill effects. The food industry, however, they were less enthusiastic with the findings, which showed a lot of the then commonplace preservatives were, in fact, really bad for you. Thus, they used their collective might and political sway to suppress papers Wiley wrote on the experiments. These efforts were ultimately fruitless, however, as Wiley saw to it that his reports got leaked to the press anyway. When the efforts to block the release of his findings failed, various industry insiders took to attacking Wiley's credibility instead, as well as spouting rhetoric like claiming he was a man who is doing all he can to destroy American business, and other stuff like that. In the end, the mob was roused thanks to his experiments, spearheaded by women's clubs across the country who tirelessly lobbied for what would become the 1906 Pure Food and Drug Act, aptly nicknamed the Wiley Act. This act, among other things, put in place rules regarding listing ingredients on labels so consumers could know, at least to some extent, what they were actually getting. The idea at this point was not so much to regulate the industries directly, but rather increase transparency so the consumers could decide whether they wanted to drink something that used formaldehyde as a preservative. This act, however, still left an amazing amount of wiggle room for various companies to exploit, culminating in the infamous Elixir Sulfanilamide incident that condemned 107 people, most of whom were children, to a slow and excruciating death thanks to the company involved adding a known highly poisonous compound to their product simply because it helps the main ingredient dissolve well in the mixture. Even when the death count started rolling in almost immediately, the company still only sent a telegram to doctors telling them to return the product, but didn't bother telling them why or express the seriousness of the issue, so many ignored the telegram and continued to accidentally kill their patients. And we're going to be looking at more on that in the bonus facts in a moment. But let's go back to the Poison Squad. The experiments they formally ended in 1907, and although Wiley would eventually be credited as being instrumental in the first significant step towards making sure food consumed in the US is reasonably safe, the contributions of the members of the Poison Squad have been largely overlooked. This is largely due to the fact that the volunteers were anonymous, meaning in most cases their names are not known, though their badass moniker of the Poison Squad certainly endured. Now, the good news is that most science doesn't require you to be poisoned, and if you'd like to explore the safer side of science, but it's no less interesting, I promise you that, then I'd recommend you do it with Brilliant. You've heard me talk about Brilliant before. They're a learning platform that focuses on active learning. This is where you're given a short bit of information on a scientific concept, and then you're asked to solve a problem that is based on that information. This is an incredibly effective way to learn. Right now, Brilliant have something that would be good as a New Year's resolution. I know it's February, but you know, it's never too late. This is called Daily Problems, and it's 5 minutes a day that you can use to exercise your brain and learn something new. Each problem provides you the context and framework you need to tackle it. That means that you can learn concepts by applying them. That's that active learning again. This sort of short daily practice can lead you from curiosity to mastery in far less time than you would think. So go to brilliant.org/todayIFoundOut and start your day a little smarter. The first 200 people to do so will also get 20% off their annual subscription and be able to view all of the problems in the archives. And let's get into that bonus fact. As noted, the Pure Food and Drug Act of 1906 still left an amazing amount of leeway to poison people to save a buck without any real consequences. This leads us to the Elixir Sulfanilamide incident. In a nutshell, sulfanilamide is actually a perfectly safe antibiotic when administered properly, and was used, among other things at the time, to good effect at treating streptococcal infections. However, in an attempt to create a liquid version of the drug, it normally came in a powder or tablet form, the lead chemist at S.E. Massingill Company, Harold Cole Watkins, mixed it with diethyl glycol, commonly used today as antifreeze and as a solvent. At the time, it was known that diethylene glycol was highly poisonous to humans, most notably causing kidney failure, but Watkins did not know this when he decided to use it in the company's elixir. He chose it because of how well sulfanilamide dissolved in the substance and because it also tasted slightly sweet, making it particularly good for getting children to take their medicine. In this case, even animal testing would not have been required to discover the substance was toxic. Watkins would have merely needed to do a surface-level look into the compound, with several previous published studies noting diethyl glycol, even in relatively small doses, would cause kidney damage and potential failure of said organ. But no such due diligence nor testing to determine the safety of an elixir before putting it on the market was required at the time. Blissfully unaware that they were about to start selling a tasty tonic of death to their customers, S.E. Massingill sent out 633 shipments of the elixir in the autumn of 1937 to pharmacists across the nation. It didn't take long for disturbing reports to begin coming in, including news of death trickling back to S.E. Massingill Company. These resulted in them issuing telegrams requesting their elixir be sent back for a full refund, though not disclosing to pharmacists the seriousness of the issue. This was all capped by a short and truly heart-wrenching letter by one Mary Nidifer to President Franklin D. Roosevelt, describing what happened in the days following administering the drug to her 6-year-old daughter, who at the time was suffering from a sore throat. It read, "The first time I ever had occasion to call in a doctor for Joan, and she was given elixir of sulfanilamide. All that is left to us is the caring for her little grave. Even the memory of her is mixed with sorrow, for we can see her little body tossing to and fro and hear that little voice screaming with pain, and it seems as though it would drive me insane. It is my plea that you would take steps to prevent such sales of drugs that will take little lives and leave such suffering behind and such a bleak outlook on the future as I have tonight." As for Dr. Samuel Evans Massingill, who owned S.E. Massingill Co., he responded to the many dozens of deaths caused by his company's negligence by issuing the following statement. "My chemists and I deeply regret the fatal results, but there was no error in the manufacture of the product. We have been supplying a legitimate professional demand, and no one could have foreseen the unlooked-for results. I do not feel that there was any responsibility on our part." Needless to say, when all of this came to light, the public were more than a little outraged with S.E. Massingill's somewhat brazen statement that his drug company wasn't responsible for making sure their products weren't simply poisoned at the recommended dose before they sold them. To add to the tragedy, it appears that Harold Watkins did not quite have the clear conscience of Dr. Massingill, with Watkins sadly committing suicide not long after it came to light that his error had resulted in the deaths of over 100 people. In the end, the elixir sulfanilamide incident was the final straw, spurring an upgrade to the Pure Food and Drug Act of 1906 in the form of the 1938 Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act to hopefully prevent such a tragedy from occurring again. Among other things, the act required that for the first time in US history, drug makers had to demonstrate to the FDA that drugs were reasonably safe before they could be marketed to the public. It also set standards for how different kinds of food should look and be packaged, and specified legal maximums for certain poisonous substances that were commonly added to food and drink at the time. So I really hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please do give us a thumbs up below, and don't forget to check out brilliant link to them below. And as always, thank you for watching.